I didn't tell Brian a lot about the message. And yet somehow God did his perfect work and got just the right songs in the mix this morning. And as we were singing and worshiping God, I was thinking, gosh, I wish we would have waited and done all these after the message. It would have made so much more sense that way. But the question is this morning, with this whole new year, what are you looking forward to? What is it that you're looking forward to in this new year of new opportunities? And the reason I ask it is because of this. This could be the beginning of the most miserable year of your life. I mean, this could be a year of just feeling like swimming in the toilet. Seriously. After some of the things that have happened in our lives, some of us may approach this new year thinking, how could it get any worse? Well, on the other hand, this could be the best year of your life so far. This could be the one that you say, I never really expected it could be this way. I never really was looking forward to all of this. God has done something new in my life when we look back at the end of the year and say, I'm so glad 2015 came around. Well, there's a question as to how will you approach that? Now, for some, they start the new year with resolutions. Anybody here setting a New Year's resolutions? Anybody? I'm not going to ask you what they are. Just raise a hand if you've set something. Okay. Okay, so for some of you who have been tainted by all the Christian literature out there, I'll ask it the other way. How many of you have set some godly goals for this new year? Okay, so now I can get that going. Okay, resolutions, goals. For many of you, if we're just brutally honest, it's semantics. It's just the same thing and said in a new way. For others of you, I'll enjoy your conversation, the connections time of your distinction between the two and why one really is more holy than the other. But I do several things throughout the year in studying God's Word. And so some of you have friended me on the Bible app, on YouVersion. And your email box got flooded on the 31st to the 1st of things that says, I was starting these new plans. Some of you are smiling because you said, yes, I need to turn those notifications off because it's getting annoying because every time he finishes reading something, I get this little pop-up. Well, I love it because it helps me to know how you're doing. I know, for instance, that Karen is doing a plan through the year based on Billy Graham's study. And so I know that she's doing so good so far. Yay, Karen! That's awesome. She asked me at the last growth group that we had if I could help her figure out how to use the Bible on her phone, because she's got one of these great big honking phones that has a screen on it bigger than old laptops. But I'm so encouraged by that. So for some of you in the room who are saying, I'm not into that whole technology thing, may Karen be your ever-shining example. Because I won't tell you how old Karen is, but that was one of the things that first struck me 4 years ago when I came here, was seeing that Karen knew that to communicate with her grandchildren, she was going to be on Facebook. And she's been one of my idols that way, in a good way, ever since. One of the plans that I do every year, not because I just love everything he does, but just because I like a fresh perspective, is a Rick Warren daily devotional. And this is, I don't know, third or fourth year I've been doing this. There's lots of others. I like some little short ones, just to get some different ideas, as well as some longer ones. And here's something he had this week that I knew was coming. Rick says, the size of your God determines the size of your goal. And godly goal setting always starts with a promise of God. Don't look at your limitations, look at the promises of God. And I think that that's where so many of us kind of fall short in setting goals or resolutions for the year. It's for many of us, it's based on a limitation that we've got, that we know of, that we want to just project ahead a little bit further than where we've been. And if you're like me, sometimes that's the problem, is I start in the wrong place. I start with my goals and my resolutions with me, rather than him. You see, if we set it with him, our goals would be greater than things we've attempted so far. Starting with the promises of God is the place to begin. And as I've been reading through stuff, wow, this is like flooded out this week. Promises of God. The psalmist would write in the longest psalm out there, Psalm 119, at verse 50. Now, most of the time you think, if I got to verse 50 of something, it's got to be over soon. Not Psalm 119. It just keeps going on and on and on and on and on. But he says, your promise revives me. It comforts me in all my troubles. The psalmist doesn't complain because he's got troubles in life. He doesn't complain because he believes in God and shouldn't have troubles. But he says this thing. Your promise revives me. Meaning, there's times I feel absolutely down and out. There's times I am so utterly discouraged. And yet when I reflect on who you are, God, and what you've said and what you've done, your promise revives me. Now, I don't know if you've thought about this, but has anybody ever said any other word before New Year's besides the word happy? Have you ever been greeted in any other way in New Year besides Happy New Year? He's different, isn't he? I like that about Ben. Why do we say Happy New Year? Why would Ben say Blessed New Year? Besides the fact he's different, which is a good thing. He's a friend, so I can say that. Two things. Either we know that the past was so bad, we're looking forward to something new, or we know that the future is going to be so great, we forget about the past. Happy New Year. Let me get you started on something. I've got a book. I wasn't really excited about the title when I was handed this book. I said, you have to read this. It's called Get a Life by Reggie McNeil. Now, for most of you, you know, I'm on a 2-year adventure, and I'm at the halfway point right now. I've been involved in something with the Churches of God, who've opened this up to other denominations. I am third UB pastor to be invited to be a part of this. It's called the Missional Leadership Initiative. In a nutshell, it's about how we get out there. It's about how we as a church move from the hope that they'll come in the doors to how we engage people around us. How we become missional as a church. How we see what are the open doors in the community that God has for us to be a blessing. And in this book, which is one of many things I've been given and looked at about making a plan for life, whether it's the SHAPE curriculum that we use, whether it's uniquely you and learning about your spiritual gifts and getting engaged in that way, whether it's creating a life plan, whether it's life coaching, there is this pervasive thought out there that most of us aren't getting it. That most of us are not experiencing life to the full the way that God would want us. Now, there's lots of them out there that are totally secular-based and saying, it's all about how can I be just be a better me. But from a Christian perspective, there's this thought out there and this experience going on of saying, we're not there. We're missing all that God would have for us. And so Reggie takes a different approach on it and says, get a life. Now, the subtitle there is, it is all about you, which is a play on words to the opening line in Purpose Driven Life that says it's not about you. And Reggie explains what he means by that in the book. Now, if you want to jot some things down on the back of your bulletin, there's 5 questions this book says that we need to ask. And the message is not about the book even. I'm going to go through these quickly. Jot these down if any one of these is ones that you have not really addressed in your life. Okay? Reggie says start with the question, why am I here? If you've never wrestled through that question, if you don't understand why you're here, you're never going to experience life. Life has to have a foundation in order to be built on, to truly enjoy the life that God would want for you to enjoy? So the first question is, why am I here? Second question is, what is really important to me? Now, the first one is fairly universal. There's certain points that all of us have in common of why am I here? I'm here because God is a God of love and has created me. But there's more to it than that. There's more to it than God wants to have a love relationship with me. God didn't need that. God was complete before he ever created us. Sometimes we think that, well, God needed someone to love, so he created us. And that's self-centered, not God-centered. But why am I here? What's really important to me? That's going to be different for every person. What's really important to you? And that's great, because the Bible says he's wired each one of us differently. Nothing wrong with that, what's really important to me. Third question is, what is my scorecard? I love this, because every time we get together 3 times a year for 3 days, then we get together in our smaller groups several times throughout. And there's this constant verbiage out there of scorecard. What's your scorecard? You know, as a church, many churches measure it in the 3 B's. Bucks, butts, and buildings. So how much money are you taking in, how many people are coming in, and how big are the buildings that you've built? For many, that's the approach. And that's got nothing to do with being a church according to the Bible. See, so Reggie asked, what's your scorecard? If what's important in your life is important, how are you measuring whether you're moving forward? If you're growing? Fourth question, he says, is what am I good at? What am I good at? And the fifth one is, what do I need to learn? And I love that chapter because that's one of my strengths and the different kinds of tests I take to learn more about who I am. Learning is my thing. If given an opportunity, I'd love to just read a book. People that want to get me gifts, get me books that know me. Besides peanut butter cups and vanilla Coke, they get me books. There's your top three, you can't go wrong with those. In the chapter, though, one of the things he talks about a lot is the things we have to unlearn. The things we have to unlearn because what we've learned so far wasn't right. Or was tainted. For me, one of the things I love to learn is the New Testament. If given an option, with the way I love to read and I love to study God's Word, I'm all about the New Testament. And what I've been learning is how much I need to study the Old Testament to get the New Testament. And so, let me share with you just a couple things that jumped out in reading that. Why that challenge needs to be taken. Why do I need to learn more about the Old Testament? Romans 15:4. If you're not familiar with that verse, jot that reference down. I'm going to have you write 3 things at the top of the back of your bulletin. Romans 15:4 says this. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the Scriptures, and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. So at the top, if you want to write this down, you should. Write endurance plus encouragement equals hope. Endurance plus encouragement equals hope. So what is hope? What is hope? My way of defining hope is that hope is a present perspective pointed at a preferred future. Hope is a present perspective pointed at a preferred future. The dictionary has a couple other things it would add. We're altering this a little way. Definition number one, dictionary.com. The feeling that what is wanted can be had or that events will turn out for the best. That's hope. Definition four is a person or thing in which expectations are centered. The Bible has lots to say about hope. The Bible has a ton to say about hope. Probably the most challenging one to me is in Romans 8:24. For in this hope we are saved, meaning the adoption of sons that Paul's talking about. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? You see, hope is like faith. In fact, Paul would say in 1 Corinthians, Faith, hope, and love are the three things that define the character of a Christian. Faith, like hope, built on something that you already have, is not really faith at all. Hope on something you already have isn't really hope. Hope is always future looking. And for some of us as Christians, we've lost our hope. And when we've lost our hope, we've lost our way. If you've lost your hope, it's time to get it back. As you approach a new year, how do you live by hope? That's why I say I love these songs that the team picked this morning, because it was all about hope. It's all about how do we get started in the right way towards the new year. Some of us, we get stuck looking at what's happened, looking at what was missed, looking at the things that we'd wished but never happened. And I love it. One of my favorite pair of verses is in Philippians 3. Paul puts his life this way, writing to a church that he dearly loves, writing to a church that is a letter all full of encouragement. Paul says, "No, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead." For Paul, what a remarkable statement. Paul has had the experience of God's blinding light. He's had the experience of Jesus alongside of him, even through bad things that have happened, even through imprisonment. Paul talks about a hope that's in the future. He says, the things that I want to be yet, I've not achieved. But here's the one thing that I do. I forget the past and look forward to what lies ahead. Even though I don't know what every step along the way is going to look like. Forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God through Christ Jesus is calling us. This time of year, there's all these new books coming out about what's your one word? Or what's your life verse? What's your theme for the new year? May that be one of them. Regardless of what the past has looked like, good or bad, I'm pressing on to receive the prize for which God has called me to. I'm running with endurance the race that's set out before me. This Old Testament stuff has helped me to understand this. I'm in, just finished Lamentations. I'm almost done with Ezekiel right now. I've gotten through some really, really depressing stuff. I mean, I love beginning in the Old Testament, getting through Genesis and seeing all this adventure story that's beginning. And you get through quite a ways and into Chronicles, it starts to get, oh, wait a minute, I already read this. And then all happened in Kings and Samuel. Yes, it did. Okay, we're reading again. We're not lost our minds. But then it just gets tough. But it depends on what you're looking for. See, because buried within all of the depressing things that are happening is God's people time and time again have turned away from him and finally get their butts kicked out of the promised land. You find nuggets like this. Of all places, Lamentations. A book about lamenting. A book about sorrow and sadness over what's happened. And yet they write this. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And I'm just awestruck at the faith of those who have gone before me. That through a miserable life that they're going through in the moment, yet some of these nuggets that we put on and we write on, you know, 3x5 cards, we stick them in our mirrors, or we have them posted around the house, and we think about his compassions never fail, they're new every morning, great is your faithfulness. And yet we don't process the context in which God inspired someone to write those words. two verses later, he says, the Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. How amazing for somebody going through such a miserable time. So, as I said, I'm reading through the message, and when I came to these verses that are familiar to many of you, and I read it like this, I had to stop and pause and read it again and say, wow, I never thought about it quite that way. The message in Jeremiah 29, about 11 to 13 says, I know what I'm doing. Now, this is God speaking. This is Jeremiah relaying God's message to the people. These aren't Jeremiah's words. These are God's words. God says, I know what I'm doing. I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not abandon you. Plans to give you the future you hope for. When you call on me, when you come and pray to me, I'll listen. When you come looking for me, you'll find me. Yes, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. God's decree. Now, those sound like great words to live by. And again, like I said last week, maybe for some of you, you're wrestling with this because it sounds great for somebody else, but you don't know what my house is like. You don't know what my family's been like. You don't know the struggles that I go through. Let me inspire you. Let me read out of the familiar translation for many of you out of NIV. The words leading up to this to describe the situation where God says these words. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. That's the setting. God's people have been carried off. The temple where they would worship has been absolutely destroyed. All the precious things in it have been carried off. The wall around the city is rubble. All of the people, except the most dirt-poor peasants, had been hauled away. There's nothing left. There's nothing to look at to say there's hope. If I'm looking at what's around me, or I'm looking at what's happened, the only opportunity is to look ahead. And God has the words that says that there is hope. He entrusted the letter to Elisha, son of Shaphan, and to Gemariah, son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. It said, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. You see, the problem was God's people are where they're not supposed to be. Sort of. God's people were supposed to be in this great land. It's the great story of the Old Testament. That God would deliver them from slavery into a land, that God would do the conquering, that they wouldn't even have to. And God would provide for them. And what he asked was that they would be an example to others. And when they didn't, God gave them a wake-up call. And as they've been hauled away, all that they do is they ask their religious leaders to say, please will you tell us that this is going to come to an end quickly and we can go back home. Yes, we've been bad. We've not followed God. Make this come to an end. And the religious leaders were doing exactly what the people wanted, saying, this is going to come to an end soon. Don't get too settled in here because this is about over. And the message that God had through Jeremiah was the exact opposite. Get settled in. Get connected. Pray for the people who are here. Because if this place prospers, then so will you. God's message was the opposite of what they had been hoping for and asking for. But God says, I know what I'm doing. The question is, do we believe that? Do we as followers today believe, even in the midst of struggles that we go through, and hardship, and pain, and loss, that God truly has a plan? That it may not be resolved in the next week, it may not be resolved in the next month, it may not even be resolved this year. But that God has a plan beyond anything we could put together on our own. God has an amazing love for us. And God says to Jeremiah in this, there is an end of this that is coming. He says, when you get serious about finding me and want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. That's God's decree. Is that the godly goal, the resolution, the thing that you've set out for in 2015? Is to get serious about finding him. His promises are that he's findable. He's not far off. He's just waiting for us to seek him with everything that we are. And then the New Testament is full of people who've written about those promises that they've learned from the Old Testament. Peter would put it this way, and because of his glory and excellence, he has given us great and precious promises. These are the promises that enable you to share his divine nature and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. Paul would put, but my life is worth nothing to me unless I use it for finishing the work assigned me by the Lord Jesus, the work of telling others the good news about the wonderful grace of God. The writer of Hebrews would put it this way, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. If that was the one thing that defined Park Church, if that was the one thing that we made a conscious effort of doing, the remainder of our days of 2015. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. It's the attitude of love that Jesus has said is the most important commandment. Love God with everything we are and love our neighbors as ourselves. How do we spur one another on toward love and good deeds? I have a challenge for you. I don't know what the reward will be, but there's going to be rewards we'll talk about next week. First person who memorizes the next verse and says it to me is going to get a reward. Ready? May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I know of no greater way to encourage you and spur you on towards love and good deeds than Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jot that reference down. I encourage you to memorize that. Make that be something that defines your life this year. And to close, I want to bless you with one last thing. Hebrews 13:20 to 21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, and ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with all you need for doing his will. May he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to him forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that you are the foundation of our hope. I thank you that you do provide everything we need to do your will, and that by your Spirit living in us, we are able. Your word is filled with promises. I've heard it's over 7,000. promises about every area of life, whether it's our finances, whether it's our marriage, whether it's parenting our kids, whether it's how we do our jobs. In every relationship, in every emotion we'll experience, you've given promises in your word. And my prayer is that we as your people would just dig in. That as we look through the scriptures together, we would encourage one another. Jesus, that we would spur one another on towards love and good deeds. God, thank you for the encouragement that you give through your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the encouragement that you give through your body of believers. Thank you for the encouragement that you give through your word that we may know you. Jesus, thank you for a new year. Thank you for the opportunities that lie before us, that this could be the best year yet. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.